नमस्ते, दिस इज डॉक्टर विशाल सक्सेना, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर इन मैथमेटिक्स एंड स्टेटिस्टिक्स इन ज्योति विद्यापीठ वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी जयपुर. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टेक अ लेक्चर ऑन द सेशन इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ सैम्पलिंग एंड द टाइप्स ऑफ सैम्पलिंग. दिस सेशन इज अ पार्ट ऑफ द कोर्स रिसर्च मेथोडोलॉजी एंड बायोस्टेटिस्टिक्स and under the program of BPT and B optometrist semester and the various other courses of the university as well as the outer universities of the other universities. So as all we know that sampling is a very important concept and types of sampling, the selection of sampling, a criteria for good sampling. So all these are important points for the researcher and for the investigator. So right from the beginning we take this topic like sampling. What is sampling? So sampling is the way of selection of just way of selection of a sample from a population. And sample, simply just sample, is a subset of the population. And population can be defined as a group of all individuals, so just we have to estimate our population, but due to the large size of population it is not possible and it will be just very expensive. So that the method of sampling just to be done for the just to find the results of population. And this way of selection of samples for the just process to apply the process for finding the results of population, just we have to do this, the procedure, and this procedure of selection of samples is called the sampling. Now sampling is of different types and just we will see what is in the process of sampling. So certain initial definitions are should be taken to understand, because we are just taking this part in brief today. Just after the selection of sample, we should take how to process this, how to start the sampling process, and how to test our just how to test our sample with the population. So first we should have to take the some hypothesis, null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis. The null hypothesis is that one, the null hypothesis is a hypothesis in which just the difference between the obtained results, observed results and the theoretical results are negligible. So null hypothesis will be taken as the hypothesis in which the difference between the observed results and the expected results will be negligible, while the alternative hypothesis is that one in which the results between the observed values and the expected values are not negligible, and these are large means a significant difference is there between the observed and the expected results. So means first we have to take just our hypothesis as null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis, and after that we have to start the process. And one is important concept is there, that is the level of significance. Just we should know what is level of significance and the critical region. So level of significance is the probability level, and it is a probability level whenever the results obtained are having the greater frequency than the theoretical level. So the hypothesis will be, the null hypothesis will be rejected, means it is the probability level. And above this, the result will be obtained, then it will be neglected, means just rejected here. That null hypothesis will be rejected. and if the just it is a probability level, and below which if the results obtained, then they will be accepted. And this region in which the null hypothesis is rejected is called the critical region. So critical region is that region in which the obtained results will be lie, then the null hypothesis will be rejected. So that is called a critical region, and in which the null hypothesis will be rejected if it lies there. So we have seen to in this way the definition of level of significance and the critical region, and we can see there what are the level of significance. So what are the level of significance? Level of significance are the 5% or the 1% or the 2%. These are the level of significance and on which the null hypothesis is to be tested. So after this we see that the definition of the large sample and the small sample. The large samples are the samples whose size is greater than 30, greater than or equal to 30. That means if n represents the size of the sample, then if n greater than or equal to 30, then it is called a large sample, and if n is less than 30, then it is called a small sample. Now how can we test our hypothesis that it would be rejected or it would be accepted, and it can be done for the different sample category, like the four the large samples. We can the distribution of the statistic should be normal, and the normal distribution can be taken as for the large sample tests, and for the small samples, that means for the small sample where n is less than 30, then t distribution test can be applied and for this testing of hypothesis. Next, how can we test? So the test can be made on the different test procedures like chi-square and ANOVA test, t distribution test, and normal distribution tests are there, and so on which here we can check the we can test our hypothesis. So we take these tests will detail in the later lectures. Today we are introducing our concept of the sampling and the types of sampling. So that is the way of selection of the sample, and some basic definitions we have taken today, the critical region and the level of significance, and the large sample and the small samples, and so that is the way. And now some errors can be generated there in the sampling process also. That is called the type 1 and type 2 errors. Type 1 and type 2 errors. So what is kind of a type 1 error? Type 1 error is that kind of error in which the null hypothesis is true, but our test rejects it. So if the test for the sampling rejects the true hypothesis, then it is called the type 1 error. While if the null hypothesis is false, but our test which we have applied for testing procedure accepts it. So means a false hypothesis is accepted, then a kind of error which is generated is called type 2nd error. So these are the two types of errors, type 1 and type 2 errors. And now we have to see what are the types of sampling, and for this we take some slides, types of sampling. So types of sampling, simple random sampling. In a simple random sampling of a given size, all subsets of a sampling frame have an equal probability of being selected So just in the simple random sampling, all the subsets of sampling frame have equal probability, mean there is no biasness, and all the just frames, all the elements are having the same chances of selection in the sample. Each element of the frame thus has an equal probability selection. Also, simple random sampling can be cumbersome and tedious when the sampling from a large target population. So it is important point, if the population which is to be tested here, if it is of large size, and in that case the simple random sampling will be difficult, will be tedious, and therefore we can just take any other kind of sampling also for our tests. Next is systematic sampling, and systematic sampling is also known as the interval sampling, in which means just we divide our study into different ordering scheme. So what is systematic sampling? It is also known as interval sampling, and it relies on arranging the study population according to some organizing scheme, ordering scheme. So first we just divide our population into ordering scheme, and then selection or the selecting elements at regular intervals through that ordered list. So after that the elements are selected in just by the ordered list at regular interval, and that's why it is called the systematic sampling. Systematic sampling involves a random start. As long as the starting point is randomized, systematic sampling is a type of probability sampling. Now next is a stratified sampling. When the population embraces a number of distinct categories, the frame can be organized by these categories into separate like strata. So in this stratified sampling, the population embraces a number of distinct categories, and the frame can be organized by these categories. Just means according to these categories the frame can be organized, and then each stratum is then sampled as an independent subpopulation. Means now here just we have to select the samples from each categorized frame. So each stratum is then sampled as an independent subpopulation, out of which individual elements can be randomly selected. So the ratio of the size of the random selection to the size of the population is called a sampling fraction. There are several potential benefits to stratified sampling. Next is the purposive sampling. As it is clear from the name of that sampling, purposive sampling, so in the sampling the researcher must just keep in the that point that what is his purpose for the sampling process. So just according to the like purpose of the sampling, just researcher will make the sampling, will do the sampling process. So purposive sampling, also known as the judgment selective or the subjective sampling, is a sampling technique in which researcher relies on his or her own judgment when choosing members of population to participate in the study. So definitely in this sampling procedure, because it will depend on the judgment of the researcher, so what kind of members should be taken and for suitable for him. So that these elements will be just selected by the sampler or the researcher. Purposive sampling is a non-probability type of sampling method, and it occurs when the element selected for the sample are chosen by the judgment of researcher. Researchers often believe that they can obtain a representative sample by using a sound judgment, and which will result saving time and money. So in this what is the main point of the purposive sampling? That the main point for the researcher or the sampler, that he should according to his objective, he will take the judgment what for the selection of the members of a sample, and the members which are suitable for the objectives are just selected by the sampler in the sampling. Next is multi-stage sampling. In multi-stage sampling, also known as multi-stages cluster sampling, is a more complex form of the cluster sampling, and this contains two or more stages in the sampler selection. So in this sampling, the selection of the sample just will be done in two different stages. And in simple terms, multi-stage sampling, large clusters of population are divided into smaller clusters in several stages. So just in several stages, the population is divided into smaller clusters, and in order to make primary data collection more manageable form. So it has to be acknowledged that multiple stage sampling is not as effective as true random sampling. However, it addresses certain disadvantages associated with true random sampling, such as being overly expensive and time consuming. So this type of multi-stage sampling can be done in the different stages, and different stages first taken from the population, and from each stage the sampler has to select some samples, so that is called the multi-stage sampling. So today's session, we have taken a very important part of the sampling procedure. We have taken some basic definitions and the types of sampling. A brief just knowledge is given to the students, and now students are advised to study all these topics, all these points, and with concepts, and just make their notes for all these points, their topics, and see the practical applications of sampling, and what are the live examples of sampling can be taken, because by these here the process of sampling can be understood in better way. With this, I conclude my today's session. Thank you.